Hello everyone, I'm Sheikh Jalal Ahmed from Fat Cat Motorsports. The more I dig into the potential environmental impact of unreclaimed or improperly reclaimed shock oil, the more concerned I get, just in terms of how much petroleum oil, petroleum byproducts are being introduced, quite likely being introduced into the environment, because there's not sufficient oversight as there seems to be with, say, motor oil or even windshield washer fluid when cars are being recycled. So I started to do more research on the industry and how recycling and scrap yards work and what they typically reclaim from the vehicles before they're, you know, the aluminum or the steel is scrapped for parts. But it wasn't clear to me how extensive and how diligent the yards are regarding taking an old shock and actually drilling properly to release the nitrogen, which in this case the SAX is actually is a twin tube. This is a twin tube damper, drilling and releasing the nitrogen and also the oil, because not every damper that leaves a vehicle goes to a proper disposal facility. I've seen some forum threads where people talk about just throwing them in the garbage and kind of laughing about it, which was really disturbing to me. So this is actually an inverted strut from a Bilstein. And it's about 200 cc fluid volume. Now this can be taken apart, but again, somebody to take it apart has to go through the effort of getting this out of the strut housing, which would look similar to this, not quite, but this would basically be inside here. So you'd have to undo a nut at the bottom, etc., to get access to this. These inverters are actually serviceable. They can be rebuilt, which is great, but very few of the dampers out there are actually that serviceable type, or at least there certainly could be more. So that's about 200 cc. This strut, which is common, a lot of vehicles out there, whatever they are, whether it's a Toyota Corolla or a Camry or a BMW or I think newer Hondas, often you see struts, both front and rear, at least in the front, and then in the rear you'll see something like this shock, and this is about 340 cc is the amount of oil that I removed from it. And this is actually AMSOIL because I'm using this for testing. That's why it has a Schrader valve. So this isn't actually from a production car currently, but this would be used on many rear shocks. Also cars that have a double wishbone front, like an Infiniti G35 or G37. Basically vehicles that do have like a shock arrangement. So this is a common volume for a lot of, you know, say mid-level or say upper market luxury cars. This is a Miata rear shock that's got about 190 cc's of oil volume. So when you just look at the damper, you don't think about the oil generally. You're like, oh, okay, it's, well, I figure that there's something going on with this, but it's not clear like there would be with an engine. Like how do you take this apart and drain the oil from it? How do you get all this oil out of it? And there's quite a lot. And again, it doesn't seem like there's sufficient compliance. It seems like there's, it seems somewhat voluntary, and that's a concern, because, you know, this is still petroleum byproducts. This is oil, hydraulic oil, that can and likely does end up in the environment, and it's not being attended to properly from what I can tell. And I've done some calculations on how much likely waste is occurring, and it's significant. It seems to be very, very significant. So this is just a short video to do a general representation of how much oil is actually in these bodies. And essentially, if you have two front, two rear, say this arrangement, you've got well over a liter, which ends up being about, I'd say, a third of a gallon. 0.28 or so gallons. 1100 cc is about 0.29 gallon. Now the amount of engine oil in the car is about 6 quarts, so that's about 1.5 gallons. So you have 3/10 or so of a gallon of shock oil that doesn't have a clear mandate. Everybody knows you don't take motor oil and throw it down the drain, or you don't take an engine and just dump it. You have to drain the oil from it. Well, where's the process to properly and safely and conveniently drain the oil? How do you drain the oil from something like this conveniently? You know, you can't. You have to drill into this. This is one of the biggest problems with having non-serviceable shocks is how do you manage the end of life? And the less convenient you make this for a scrapyard, where I found statistics, and I think I mentioned this in the past video, 86% of service of scrapyards are run by 10 or fewer people, and 20% of them are run by one person. How long does it take to drill into a shock? This is going to take you several minutes. You know, you have to have the right jig, you have to make sure your drill bit's squared, it's sharp, it's not going to break. If it breaks, you have to replace it, put another one in. I mean, I've done this myself numerous times to get into shocks. And how much are you getting from servicing this if you have to break into every single one by drilling into it? And then you have to, you know, pump it to drain it. You have to, you know, work this to drain the oil out of it. That's going to take some more time. You're talking at least 5 minutes plus. So I'm very, very passionate about this. This is actually the real reason why I got into science. My main interest was environmental conservation and environmental cleanup. Environmental health and toxicology was my intended major at San Jose State when I started. And I had to change out of the program because it was impacted. It was going to take me 7 years to get my bachelor's degree, so I switched ultimately and ended up in physics. So now I understand the physics of how these devices work, and I've come back to seeing that there's a major environmental concern. And I'm going to continue doing research. From what I can tell, this is being overlooked. This is a gray area in terms of compliance. And the harder manufacturers make it for people to service, to even for disposal, if you say, okay, this strut has got 100,000 miles, it can't be reused, I'm dubious about that, because if you change certain components, I believe it can be reused. I've seen that. But if you have an end-of-life strut, you have all this oil in there, what's the process to make sure that this does not end up getting bent, broken, and then leaking into the environment? Because you end up with a significant amount of oil. And I'll do more videos where I talk about and I show calculations for how much oil is going in. So keep this in mind, people. You know, this is, you know, how much are we aware of this? You know, you take a shock and you throw it out. I mean, how many times have we changed shocks and we either, maybe we put it in the back of the garage, or maybe we just throw it in the dumpster, you know? I mean, how diligent are we about this? If there was a process to recycle them or even reuse them, rebuild them, this would make an impact across so many levels of the world. Internationally, this isn't just about the U.S. It's global. So thanks for watching. Thank you for thinking about this and helping me see, like, man, this is definitely getting me very interested and looking in more detail and being much clearer on what, you know, what, just because it's hidden doesn't mean that there's not something potentially harmful that can be released if it's not attended to properly. It's just to draw proper attention to this subject. So thank you.